hi, everyone, and welcome to the seminar. My name is Rebecca, and I work in the research division where I co-direct the Center for Biodiversity and Community Science. And I'm super thrilled to welcome our seminar speaker today, Rebecca Kim, who's our librarian, and I invited Dr. Chris Schell and his lab to come today so we could hear about some of their research. Dr. Schell is a professor at UC Berkeley in the Environmental Sciences and Policy Management Department. Go Bears. His lab is an incredible group of people, and you'll hear a lot about their work today. But I just want to say it's such a joy to have Chris and his team in the Bay Area. They've really just brought this like spirit of collaboration and thinking about wildlife and people and social justice and equity into this space in the Bay Area in like a real tangible way. And so it's really great to have them as colleagues across the Bay. Chris will talk about his work now, but really he studies the interactions of society and ecology and evolution to understand how wildlife are adapting to life in cities, which you can see here from our title, and really how systemic racism and oppression affect urban ecosystems. And this is like my favorite line, this is from his bio, and the need for environmental justice and civil rights and equity as a bedrock for conservation and in the fight against climate change. So I'm gonna, without further ado, I'm gonna welcome Chris, and we'll look forward to hearing his stuff.
Can y'all hear me okay over the mic?
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, okay. Sup, y'all? How you doing?
Hello.
It's good to be here. Again, most of y'all I see at least on a weekly basis. But some of you, I only get a chance to see every once in a while. So appreciate y'all giving me the platform. I want to say before I even get started in earnest that there are a lot of folks to thank because this work takes a village, takes a tribe. And this is a tribe that I am proud to call myself to be a part of. I cannot express to you how awesome it has been to work with these amazing people for the last 2 years. And I may start crying before I even actually get into the talk itself. But I am going to take the opportunity today to detail all of the amazing work that they have been doing and how this work helps us to understand how we reconnect ourselves back to nature, back to the natural world, how we start to do the work of healing, which as y'all probably know, right, we are in dire straits when it comes to that healing. So I'm sure when you guys were reading the title, you thought of one person, right? Stevie Wonder? Maybe you thought of this song right here? Can you hear that? Yeah? Do it a mic? I'm gonna let that rock a little bit. Now, in all actuality, I probably could play this song for the remainder of the talk and y'all would be fine with it. And I don't blame you. I mean, it's Stevie Wonder, right? But there's a reason why we started this off with Stevie Wonder and specifically the song Living for the City. A lot of the work that we do is couched in this understanding of not only how our animals living in the cities, not only how cities are alike from city to city to city, but also how do we operationalize ourselves as scholars, as activists, as healers to think about the city, not just for each other, but for everybody else, for all of the human and the non-human things. Should be noted that this framework was generated by one of the four people of the field in urban ecology, Dr. Stuart Pickett, who's been in the game for a minute, right? Even before urban ecology was a thing in the 1990s. And he and colleagues came up with a framework talking about the ecology in cities, trying to address really the ways in which the biology of our cities across multiple ecological scales are interacting with the urban infrastructure and with human activity. Yeah, we got that one. Ecologists do that quite a bit. What about the ecology of cities? Well, here we investigate those ecosystem properties, still very much couched within ecological theory, still very much Western science, but it's not until we get to the ecology four cities that we start to harness all of that knowledge, all of that advancement to try and understand how do we use what we've learned from the in and the of to actually get to the four. That's the hardest part, right? That part is how do we start to influence culture for the better? How do we start to do co-production properly? How do we start to authentically think about the ways in which social and environmental justice are at the forefront? How do we start to think about the ways we dismantle systems of capitalism that destroy the natural world around us? And that journey for me in particular started with this dude right here. How many of y'all have seen this photo? Just go ahead and raise your hand. For those of you that are in the lab, yes, I get it. You've seen this. You've seen me give this photo in a version of this talk multiple times. But I'm assuming the majority of you who aren't in the Schell lab have not seen this photo. It's a fantastic story. So in 2007 in downtown Chicago, and no, I'm not talking about Schomburg. No, I'm not talking about O'Hare. I'm talking about downtown on State Street. There's a Quiznos, right? Slower Whacker. Okay. And there is a coyote in April of 2007 that saunters into this Quiznos. There are a couple of folks making sandwiches. There are a couple of folks eating sandwiches. They stop doing that. They get out of the establishment and this coyote proceeds to jump into the drink cooler. And not only just jump into the drink cooler, but as you can see, these are not Photoshop. These are actual photos. The animal falls asleep. That coyote stays in the drink cooler for a full 50 minutes before animal care and control comes to then relocate that individual. And that has driven me. Why on earth would that animal choose that reality? Some of y'all may be, say, Westworld fans, right? You question the nature of your own reality. I think this animal was straight up out of the Matrix and said, nah, I'm just gonna play with these folks and get up in this drink cooler. Like to think that this is an isolated incident, right? Here's the cool thing. When I give versions of this talk to other folks, they think I'm crazy, but y'all live in San Francisco, so you know it gets crazier. And it doesn't just happen in Chicago. It happens on trains in Portland where coyotes are like, nah, this is my train, bruh. You catch the next one. It happens with folks feeding pizza to coyotes. This photo in the bottom left is of the pizza coyote in Huntington Beach, California, which was getting a slice every other week. And certainly, as you can imagine, this generates a whole manner of conflicts, many of which are being studied by the folks in this room today. So shout out to Tali and Christine for providing some photos therein, as well as the rest of the lab. You'll get a chance to see some of them, where we have animals that are in these urban environments giving two you-know-whats. Right? They are eating cats. They are as close to people as possible, laying down as if nothing is happening. They are the poster childs of urban wildlife, to the point where we've been able to capture several videos of their behavior in response to people. This one over here, provided by SFACC. And Kristen can correct me if I'm wrong on this one, but I believe this was in the botanical garden, correct?
Yep.
So this animal is slowly walking. For those of you that don't know what this type of behavior it is, it's stalking. So normally, if a coyote were going after some prey, it would slowly move in this fashion. Now, what's remarkable is that most folks around the animal don't know that it's there. There are some folks across the pond that certainly see this animal as it's moving. What do you think it's stalking?
Bird.
Fish. There is a small child right there with their father, right? Not only that, this video taken personally by Tali is of a coyote. I'm assuming while you were doing fecal transects, is that right, Tali? And this coyote could care less that Tali is there. Not only that, the animal is sniffing and oh, there you get the marking. That is the proverbial middle finger to us. I would see it quite often as a graduate student where the animal would essentially either defecate or urinate in front of me to say, this is my territory. I'm not going anywhere. So these animals have gotten to the point where they very much are habituated to and are used to human activity at levels that we do not normally see in non-urban environments. So again, that coyote in the Quiznos, not an isolated incident. It really calls into question how we share our natural world and our urbanized world with all of the other things that exist in that sphere. So I have to say, well, handsome, right? Good looking dude. Y'all know this. Ian Malcolm, played by Jeff Goldblum, the original Jurassic Park movie. I'm assuming most of y'all got into science because of this handsome Adonis right here, right? He infamously had this line, life finds a way. Now, this was an allusion to the fact that there were going to be dinosaurs breaking out of these man-made enclosures, essentially turning what we thought were going to be very structurally sound things into a house of cards. And we oftentimes in the lab say just this. In fact, Christine is wearing a shirt today that says life finds a way. We do think, yes, life finds a way, dot, 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 in cities. So much so that there are urban organisms all over the place across multiple types of cities, across multiple biomes that are making it work. From javelina in Tempe, Arizona, to smooth-coated otters in Singapore, raccoons in the Pacific Northwest, and everything in between. What's remarkable about all of these adaptations, flexibilities, plasticities, or otherwise, is that we can then start to document not only that there are behavioral changes for these wildlife populations, but that there are physiological and genomic changes as well. So we're starting to understand that as wildlife are coping with these cities, they are also evolving to the characteristic fundamental structures of what a city is, from noise and food to pollutants and building densities. And this has spawned a tremendous amount of research in the last 10 years, taking a look at the evolution of organisms in cities, so much so that we can start to see what mechanisms are at play, whether they are adaptive or neutral evolution, as well as what locations. And then that helps us to unpack even further still the ways in which many of these mechanisms are generated or driven by human influence, whether it be, say, politics and socioeconomic status, human health and demographics, or transportation and infrastructure. Here's the important piece for y'all to take away, and I'll keep saying it over and over and over again in very different ways. In all of these lessons that we've been learning, human beings are both the directors and the audience of this adapted screenplay. I like to joke that we are the Lin-Manuel Miranda of this joint. Not only did we compose all of the songs, did we draw the curtains back, did we make all of the casting calls, we even put together that rotating stage, right? Clever little rotating stage. We also are acting in this play. We also are seeing it as it unfolds. We also are trying to sing better than Leslie Odom Jr. And we know we're not better than that dude, but we do it anyway, right? So being able to understand the ways in which we move forward, especially in the middle of a biodiversity crisis, a climate crisis, means that we have to uncover how our urban landscapes are driving local adaptation and how that will be essential for the ways in which we build targeted management and conservation strategies to maintain biodiversity in cities. Some of y'all may be asking, well, why in cities? Well, as you know, more than half of the human population exists in cities today. By the time 2100 rolls around, two-thirds of the entire human population will live in cities. These are just reports that were put out recently for COP15, right? Not only that, the amount of urbanized landscape is going to increase a millionfold. That means that the amount of urbanized landscape that's going to exist into the future doesn't already exist. That's new urbanized landscapes. So we need to figure out a solution quick, fast, and in a hurry. And that means thinking about biodiversity, not only as the things that are outside and their intrinsic value, but also their relative importance to maintaining the tapestry around us. Many of y'all already know this. I am going to keep doing it over and over because I think the cognitive heuristics really hit. I'm a Marvel fan. I'm a huge Marvel fan, although I haven't seen Quantumania, so don't ruin it for me. Jonathan Majors is my dude. Biodiversity as the shield, right? The ecosystem services provided by that shield and the ways in which we consider ourselves part of that nature is critically important because biodiversity in cities provide myriad untold contributions to people, some of which we can't even calculate. We had a really good conversation earlier today about how folks are asking for coyotes to pay taxes. And if they only knew that coyotes are not only paying taxes in a way maybe that they don't necessarily understand, but that they are getting the benefit of that for free. you're welcome. The coyotes are doing that for you, right? Not only are there, say, cultural benefits, benefits to maintaining ecosystems, but there are also benefits to maintaining our own health. So the framework of One Health talks about the ways in which our interconnectedness, not just to the environment, but also to all of the other non-human organisms that live in that environment, maintain our health and well-being. So yes, this is rather selfish for us to think about the ways in which biodiversity help us out. But it is important to do this exercise to critically examine, interrogate, and investigate the ways in which we are detrimentally affecting us too. And that brings us to thinking about the ways in which climate, people, and nature all intersect. Because as I mentioned earlier, climate crisis, biodiversity crisis, wage inequality, the unhoused and not having affordable housing, lack of transportation, lack of municipal services, they all wrap in with each other. And humans show up in every single piece of this puzzle. So in order for us to put the puzzle together, right? Think of this as a 1,000-piece puzzle. It's going to take all of us. And that means we have to unpack this catch-all of people, because we'll think of climate change and nature and people together, right? But we know that not everybody on the landscape has the same amount of power, same amount of privilege. They're not influencing the landscape in the same ways, right? If we just take people alone, we can start thinking about how culture and governance, beliefs and values, wealth, policy, and histories, and that's just a small smattering of the many, many, say, multitudes of layers that we need to start thinking about within society, because how we shape those societal factors necessarily influence the biology of our cities, necessarily influence our ability to save said biodiversity. So say, for instance, y'all are conservation scientists, right? And maybe you don't do conservation inside of the city, but you are interested in conservation writ large, and you know that we need to conserve these species for the integrity of whatever ecosystem you're working in. And you may be thinking, all right, Chris, well, I'm not an urban ecologist. I don't work in cities. Well, as y'all know, there is not one place on this planet that isn't directly or indirectly touched by people. So therefore, if we don't start to understand ourselves, if we don't put ourselves on the couch real quick, right, and start actually going to collective human therapy, then we will never get to our conservation goals. So that means we got some time traveling to do. Yes, again, I did say I was a Marvel fan, right? We need to be able to learn from our past and how it shaped our present, because that present and those lessons from the past are the key to our more biodiverse, more just future. So how do we do that, right? As social ecological scientists, we think about this quite a bit, but maybe some of y'all are like, all right, cool. I'm hearing a lot of like, we need to blend people in with nature, but also think about justice and how not all peoples have a seat at the table. How do we start? Well, let's, again, do some time traveling and something as basic as legacy effects. Some of y'all may have heard of this, some of you have not. Legacy effects in general, in a nutshell, describe the way in which a species has a profound impact on an ecosystem that can last multiple generations, even when that organism is out of the ecosystem. And legacy effects in ecology oftentimes are reserved for some of those ecosystem engineers. One of the most impactful ecosystem engineer is humans. So thinking about the ways in which, say, agricultural activities completely change the soil chemistry of any potential given area, right? Completely changes primary and secondary succession, changes what other species live in those neighborhoods, changes what other species are able, say, primary producers, primary consumers, able to persist, which will then influence secondary, tertiary, quaternary consumers. So the entire ecosystem is fundamentally changed just by growing a few plants for food. So legacy effects are a great way for us to bridge space and time, because they underscore the profound impacts that anthropogenic activity have on an ecosystem's ability to change. And those human impacts leading to those ecosystem transformations are the very lessons we need to understand how disturbance regimes and local conditions are changing the ecological responses therein. So luckily, Romalo and Hobbs back in 2012 were ahead of the game with this. In their paper in Tree, they talked about the ways in which we can start to integrate not only lessons across spatial distributions, but also across time, which is exactly what we need. Because as we know, right, scientists in this room and those of you that are on the StreamYard right now, a good chunk of the climate impacts we're feeling today are those that were implanted 30, 40, 50 years ago. That carbon we're just now feeling. So imagine that the ways in which we build cities are also going to impact how organisms that aren't even born yet are going to be responding to us. So that's what underscores our ability and our kind of thought process in the lab to start interrogating how these human historical legacies in cities are associated with urban heterogeneity. And of course, right, urban ecological systems serve as the petri dish, the empirical test example, right, environment, if you will, to try and really unpack the ways in which human activity influences wildlife therein. So we customarily take a look at this diagram as we do so often. Shout out to Dr. DeRoche, who put this figure together for our recent science paper, taking a look at how past societal legacies influence the present, where we really underscore how structural racism and classism, whether it be through residential segregation, resource allocation, gentrification, and the like, all are influenced by those systemic biases that feed on up. They influence where the impervious surfaces are, where the tree cover is, where the pollutants are, where the heat is, i.e. where the disturbances are that these other non-human organisms are responding to. So we can't understand ecological disturbances or attractants without understanding the root causes of all of it. Okay, exercise time. Again, for those of you that are in the lab, this is like the fifth time you've done it, but play along, okay? Everybody is going to be Groot in this room, including the folks that are in StreamYard. You're gonna all act like you're Groot and you're gonna follow the trees as I show you a side-by-side comparison of two different neighborhoods in the Pacific Northwest, not too far from each other, okay? So I am Groot, y'all are Groot, we are Groot. Let's take a look at these trees. Okay, on the left side of the screen is a township to the southwest of downtown Tacoma called University Place. All right, on the right side of the screen is another neighborhood about a half mile away from University Place called Southeast Tacoma, which ironically is actually just directly south of downtown Tacoma. Now, if I were to ask y'all, I just want you to point, right? Use your fingers. This is us exercising our ability to move our bodies in a seminar. If I were to ask you, which of those two neighborhoods would you say has a greater vegetation or tree canopy cover? Which photo would you point to? Okay, easy one. Everybody got that one, right? You should get that one right. If I then ask you a follow-up question, and I say with the follow-up question, all right, y'all, of these two neighborhoods, which would you expect to have a higher median household income? Which one would you point to? The one on the left. That intrinsic knowledge that somehow more vegetation correlates to more socioeconomic wealth, it has a name. It's called the luxury effect. So I did that species richness, so the number of species we're able to count in an area, and biodiversity, the relative distribution and abundance of those species therein, are positively associated with socioeconomic wealth, right? Now, this isn't always the case, but certainly it should be noted that this is a case for a lot of different communities across many different trophic levels, from primary producers, like those tree species, all the way up to tertiary consumers. This is a pretty widespread phenomenon that doesn't just happen in US cities. Some of these studies are in cities outside of the United States. And we probably could hazard a guess that socioeconomic wealth also predicts in many other cities some of these similar relationships. But it should be noted that many of these studies only look at one city, one community at a time. So some of the work that we have been doing is using these camera traps to take a look at whether or not there are any differences in distributions, not just in one city for one community, but for multiple cities at a time. This has a point, right? Here's one of the figures from one of the recent papers we put together, taking a look at the overall species richness from city to city. Here in the what's called the UN Network, Urban Wildlife Information Network, we were able to document 20 of our now 42 cities and look at how many of the species have been documented and then count using kind of the correlation between species richness and a city's income gradient, whether or not there were any positive effects. So let me explain this figure to you. If you're looking on the right of this figure, now it's a little hard to see for those of you that are in the room, but there's a dashed line right in the center of that figure, okay? If you have the normal distribution curve, so the blue area of each of those cities, to the right of that line, then that means that there is, in fact, this positive relationship like we would predict. More wealth, more species richness, particularly here for mammals. However, if you start to get further and further down that line, if that blue area in any way is overlapping that dashed line, that means there is no general relationship between the number of species we're able to detect and a neighborhood socioeconomic status. And it certainly can be said that for St. Louis, all the way down to Madison, Wisconsin, yeah, there does seem to be this positive relationship. And St. Louis and Seattle, very different from each other and yet show very similar results, right? Seattle is a particularly green city, which is part of the reason why it's called the Emerald City. St. Louis, if y'all have been there before, you probably would say, oh, of course it's number one, because that city is extraordinarily segregated, but those two are right next to each other. If we keep going down that line, though, we start seeing that Atlanta, Metro LA, Edmonton, Alberta, not so much. So wealth only gets us so far, which means that we have to dig a little bit deeper. And when we start doing that digging, we start to realize that when other luxury effect papers are also interested in seeing whether or not there is, in fact, this positive relationship, it doesn't always hold. So this figure over here, done by Evan Kuros and company, take a look at least at the time, and this was 2020, all of the papers to date that were interested in the luxury effect and whether or not there was this positive relationship like we would predict, a neutral relationship, meaning there is no relationship between species richness and socioeconomic status, or the complete opposite, a negative, whereas if a neighborhood gets more and more expensive, you see less and less species within said neighborhood. And then they split up between flora and fauna animals. In most of the residential spaces, here you can see here and here, there's a positive relationship like we would expect, but it's not 100%. Once you start getting into mixed residential and non-residential or fully non-residential, that flips on its head. Even looking at density is not a 100% yes, there's a positive relationship. So that means what other legacies that have influenced the urban landscape are relevant to these conversations? And perhaps one of the ones that have caught the most fire recently and maybe called the lowest hanging fruit is redlining. So for those of you that don't know what redlining is, it essentially was a policy that systematically denied the rights of certain people, persons of color in particular, African Americans, to be able to afford and buy homes in areas that were predominantly wealthy and white. And in order to do that, the Homeowners Loan Corporation, with the sponsorship of the US government, put together these color-coded maps. This one over here is of Oakland, where the green and the blue, the A and the B areas respectively, were reserved for wealthy white Americans, whereas the C and the D, the yellow and the red, were for everybody else. You couldn't afford to live in the other areas, you were relegated there. If you were a person of color, you were relegated there. If you were an immigrant, you were relegated there. And most of the pollution burdens, the toxic sittings, were proximal to those neighborhoods. So even if you had the economic mobility to be able to afford a home in one of those A or B regions, there were a whole bunch of laws on the books and off the books that prevented you from doing so. Everything from a real estate agent tailing you and then reporting you to the police that you were in that neighborhood, to even having certain neighborhoods be sundown towns. Essentially, if you were a person of color caught in that neighborhood after sundown, you'd be apprehended and lynched on site, right? So there were a bunch of different laws, which if you're interested in the history of redlining, this book right here written by Richard Rothstein is fantastic. it will give you a lot of the background around it. But we think of these maps constantly because the spatial distribution essentially of the past showing itself, the ghosts of the city, as one of the graduate students, Cesar Essien, would point out. All of these cities have their own histories and the ways in which they were chopped and screwed six ways to Sunday. Here's what's depressing, y'all. I started with 61 and I ended with 108. There were more than 230 cities that have these redlining maps. If you want to get more access to these maps, there are also shapefiles provided here by the University of Richmond's Mapping and Equality Project. They not only have redlining maps, they have gentrification maps, they have maps on urban renewal, they have maps on where the pollutant burdens sit. They have quite a bit and they've done a whole lot. So when we're thinking about these maps and we're thinking about, say, how are animals navigating the landscapes? What are they experiencing within their own urban environments? Here are just four of them. Tacoma, Seattle, San Francisco, Oakland. Los Angeles isn't even in here, right? We're thinking about the ways in which these animals may be going from blue to yellow or yellow to red. For coyotes, for instance, we know that they're hyper-territorial and oftentimes will use different landmarks to demarcate where their territories are. Imagine if you are living a cushy life, right? And you're living in that blue area right over here. Guess where this bounds? Where we are. There's the park, right? And there are some researchers in here who will tell you stories about how the coyotes here are living and sitting pretty. Imagine the animals that are living over here. What type of struggles are they going through? What are their lives like? How are they surviving the urban matrix? Even in the way in which animal societies are partitioned across the landscape is unequal. Think about that for a second. The animals that live here up in the Presidio are not living the same lives as the animals that live over here in Bernal Heights. Bernal Hill, right? Either is right. So back to people. I did say we were being a little people-centric, even though I'm a biologist, right? Here's the thing. I did say that all of this was connected to our health as well. Those past legacies are currently influencing our environmental health too. Now, I like to label this particular, and I see that there are older folks here, but maybe you watch this with your kids. Avatar The Last Airbender is phenomenal. It is a great show, and I will say that this portion of the talk is dedicated to that show because in every single way, redlining is influencing Earth. Yes, I'm stretching it a little bit. I know that the trees are not necessarily Earth, but we saw how the trees potentially could be influenced. There are also influences on urban heat and air and water. Let me detail them for you. So there's greater air pollution in previously redlined areas. Look at the date on that paper. Nguyen et al. 2020, right? These are current measurements. There are more intensified urban heat islands in those redlined areas as well. Also 2020. There are more frequent ER visits, rates of asthma, and cancer for folks that live in previously redlined neighborhoods. Nardone, 2020. And a couple of papers, one that was just recently published, one that's in production from a couple of colleagues that I know, taking a look at how urban tree canopy cover and a myriad number of environmental characteristics, size of the green space, complexity of that green space, diversity in that green space are also influenced by redlining maps. So there are overall disparities in the ecosystem services that are provided for majority communities of color in these previously redlined neighborhoods that today are still being felt. To go back into the story, those redlining maps were abolished in the 1960s, 1968 specifically. It's been over 50 years, and we're still seeing the impacts of those pollutants. We're still seeing the impacts of those redlining maps. We're still seeing the impacts of disinvestments in certain communities over others. And this is a problem that was generated before most of us were born. We got work to do. So you may be asking, all right, well, redlining seems to be influencing human health, and it seems to be influencing at least the primary producers, but what about the biology of our cities? Turns out, paper by Schmidt and Garraway provides some maybe convincing evidence, jury's still out, that genetic diversity is reduced in red line neighborhoods relative to other neighborhoods. One of the other colleagues we work with, Diego Elisoto and company, used iNaturalist data to see whether or not there were any differences in the number of species counted in each of these regions, and does find that community science reports tend to be higher in those A-graded areas. Now, there is some impending data that may suggest otherwise, but we'll get to that when we get to that. So this is all just to say we still have a long way to go. There is a lot of work to be done to try and uncover essentially the bones of our past to really understand what that means for our present and our future. And we use coyotes as well as raccoons and other urban carnivores as our bioindicators, as our conduits to better understand the ways in which we are connected to the landscape and how as a society we can collectively come together to start making some positive, impactful change. And this is where I turn to some of the amazing work that many of the folks in this room have started and are currently doing in examining how social heterogeneity and environmental health shape the ecology of urban wildlife within our cities. One of the three major pillars of the research arms that y'all are doing here at the Cal Academy of Sciences is the Thriving California Initiative. And that's exactly where we have positioned ourselves to be able to help collectively build this knowledge and work with our communities. And we do that through incredibly simple means: cameras, carcasses, and collars. And certainly I should put in there parentheses community, which seems to reign supreme over all three of those, right? None of this work is possible without community support. But these are really simple means. We can use cameras to document how wildlife are moving across cities. We can use carcasses in every part of the carcass to understand what the animal is eating, its population genomic structure, how stressed that animal was. Is it exposed to anticoagulant rodenticides? Is it exposed to heavy metals? And then, of course, collars to help us tell stories, tell the stories for the animals that they themselves don't necessarily tell to us. How are the animals navigating from spot A to spot B? How are they navigating around people? What does it mean that they are choosing to cross one road and not the other? So just to give you a little bit of glimpse into some of the work that we have already done to this point, we have begun launching our long-term ecological monitoring project under the Urban Wildlife Information Network, setting up cameras all across the East Bay. This map, for instance, was put together by Dr. Parker Shames, appreciate you, Phoebe, looking at the disparities in socioeconomic status and where we have our cameras. So now that we've had a year's worth of data to collect, we're starting to analyze those data and see whether or not there are differences in biodiversity patterns as a function of maps like these. And of course, we also get amazing videos. So not only are the cameras good for still images, they're good for seeing how the animals behave in space and time. And who doesn't love a group of raccoons just chewing a stick that I just touched? I just touched a stick. And they're like, oh, this is different. This is new. Raccoons are fantastic. So we're getting quite a bit on these cameras, right? Some of the species aren't even documented here. Everything from, yes, the possums, to this lovely fox over at a faculty's residence, which, as you can imagine, a good chunk of this work, because it's grassroots driven and community driven, there are a bunch of folks that are interested in having a camera in their backyard because they've seen wildlife. They have community knowledge where they themselves can participate as experiential experts, right? The scientists on the ground, which we very much love being able to do that. Gray foxes, bobcats, striped skunks, and deer. But not only are we using our cameras to kind of document what wildlife are moving where, we're then starting to make moves into understanding more explicitly how is environmental health also impacting the ways in which animals are present, as well as the ways in which animals move through the landscape. So this is some work that's been spearheaded by Dr. Christine Wilkinson and our contacts over at UCANR using the Cal Enviro Screen Map, essentially developed by the Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessment, to then create these spatial boundaries by neighborhood to try and understand where are the environmental burdens across all of California using 21 different indicators, looking at pollution burdens, as well as the likelihood that you would then be in, say, proximity to those burdens. And Christine created these maps using movement data from some of these coyotes to get home ranges of the animals. And then we can overlay those home ranges on a map that takes a look at the pollution burdens. So this map that you're taking a look at right now has the home ranges outlined and the pollution burden by percentile, right? And this figure over here takes a look at the amount or the distribution of pollution burden. So the size of an animal's home range, we're starting to see scales with the pollution burden. What does that mean? Animals that are more exposed to more pollutants, higher air pollutants, more heavy metals, et cetera, are more likely to have higher, larger home ranges. Why? We don't know. We don't get in the lab and find that out. Maybe it's possibly because animals that do have neighborhoods, territories with higher pollution burdens need to move more to get the resources that they need to persist in the environment. So they're having to do a little bit extra just to make it work. You don't even know all that. Okay. Now is the time where I get to introduce all of the awesome work that y'all have been doing, right? So for instance, one of the postdocs in the lab, Dr. Christine Wilkinson, has been taking a look not only at how coyotes move across this urban landscape that we call San Francisco, but has also been interested in the ways in which spotted hyenas and community members interact with each other. And this is exciting work because it is oftentimes not done and undervalued in a way that really doesn't get at the root causes of how people and carnivores are able to interact. One of the awesome pieces of kind of figures that she recently put together was this one in the bottom left corner of hotspots of conflict across San Francisco in the last, would you say, 10 years? Decades worth of data. SF Animal Care and Control had a decade worth of data of conflict. And Christine was like, all right, I got you. And put together this awesome map. Or let's take Dr. Lauren Stanton, doing some amazing work looking at the cognitive capabilities of animals across those landscapes as a function of those maps that you see, using stuff as simple as a PVC puzzle. Look at how these animals are trying so hard to get the food reward inside. And that tells us a whole lot about the capabilities of those animals, the strategies that they use, differences across those species, and eventually we can then correlate those data to whether or not there are differences in the ways in which those animals are having to deal with the stressors of an urban environment. Y'all get this, right? If you have a very important test, you don't eat anything all day, you feel like crap, you haven't had any water, and you've had to walk 5 miles. How would y'all do on that test? Pretty bad, right? Imagine what these animals are experiencing. Then we have Dr. Parker Shames, Phoebe over there in the back, doing a lot of interdisciplinary work, taking a look at how animals are responding to cannabis farm and cannabis grows. So how does industry impact the ways in which animals are then navigating our stuff? Again, a resounding theme, right? How are human beings generating the ways in which these animals are navigating these landscapes? And certainly interdisciplinary conservation is exactly what we need. So to some of the work that the graduate students are doing as well, Cesar Estien over there in the back has been very much interested in the social ecological drivers of wildlife behavior. And one of the projects that he has been doing in the last, I would say, year and a half, really strong, are using novel objects to see how animals respond to differences in novelty. Are they bold enough that they will venture in to get a food reward, or will they stay away like this animal did over here? Right? Here is a control site where we put in the ground what's called sweet meat and then bury it. But we do the same thing here with the treatment site, except put up 4 fence posts, really simple fence posts. You think, whatever, that's not really a novel object that should scare an animal. And yet the response here is very different than the response here. I told y'all we were in the lab, right? I told you we were getting at it, right? Tyus, who a good chunk of y'all got a chance to hear some of the work he's been doing, he's doing some really good, exciting, and likely arduous work for those of you that have outdoor cats. This is your daily PSA. Keep your cat indoors. Tyus will tell you why, right? Keep your cat indoors for all of the reasons, but likely some of the biggest reasons being that they are incredibly efficient killers. They are able to depredate a ton of biodiverse species all across our urban landscapes, and they are vectors of disease. Not only diseases that infect other organisms, but diseases that infect us, like toxoplasmosis. So for all of the reasons, conservation, One Health or otherwise, talk to Tyus. Alexis is also in that same ilk, thinking about the ways in which health, public health, One Health, wildlife health, all coalesce with each other, and just so happened to choose a species that may have a couple of other additional coronaviruses that we may need to be concerned about, right? So how do we think about urban bats in our urban system? I know that I have a couple of bats in my backyard, but I couldn't tell you what they look like. I couldn't tell you their abundance. And I bet that most folks in the urban environment, specifically in the San Francisco Bay Area, may not even know that we have bats. And in summer, does extraordinary work on the molecular and genomic stuff. I should say that she is spearheading that in ways that the rest of the lab couldn't even dream of doing, right? There are levels of complexity to this, and I am not on the same level with Summer. And I appreciate having that perspective and trying to understand how all of the little things, there's quantum mania again, right? All of the little things matter. So a lot of the work that she's been doing in the past is how differences in bear diet then influence the microbiome that then potentially influence the ways in which those animals come into conflict. And then finally, but certainly not least, Tali Caspi, which Tali, again, thank you for the videos and the photos, has been doing extraordinary work over the last 3 to 4 years, collecting a bunch of scat and carcasses from across San Francisco to look at their diet, their ecophysiology, how hormones and diet and stable isotopes and the microbiome all coalesce to influence dietary specializations. So certain animals eat certain things and certain animals eat other things. And all of this work is extraordinarily exciting. So get your popcorn ready. We're just getting started, right? And our hope is that through many of these different initiatives, all of what I've shared with you today, are things that we can start to weave in better with the Cal Academy. So I'll leave you with this as my final slide, a line from James Baldwin about us understanding our place in history and our place into the future. Very Afrofuturistic. The great force of history comes from the fact that we carry it within us, are unconsciously controlled by it. History is literally present in all that we do. And hopefully, now at the end of this talk, I have convinced you of that. Not only is it in us unconsciously, but now as you go out into the city, I hope you think of many of those aspects in a very conscious way, because growing that consciousness is the way in which we will begin to advance into a better future. And a lot of future generations need it, right? I have a 4 and a 7-year-old. They very much are concerned about losing biodiversity, losing multiple species, changing of the climate. I do this for them. You find the ways in which you do it for others and keep it. So many thanks to all y'all in the room. Many thanks to all y'all in StreamYard. Thanks to all of the folks in the lab for putting together slides so in that way I can highlight and elevate y'all's work. I hope that you ask a bunch of questions from all of the experts that are in the room. They will tell you almost anything and everything about this urban ecosystem, and I will open for any questions y'all have.
So I have a question. Cities, Rust Belt cities, Detroit, Buffalo, places that were industrial but now are depopulated by people.
Yep.
I wonder if you all have had any opportunity to look there, because there's a lot of wildlife comes from Detroit. So it's interesting to shift. It's turning into nature. I'm just curious.
Yeah. So we don't have any empirical evidence to fit curves like the ones you saw to Detroit, but if I had to hazard a guess, and we do, I should say, have colleagues, Dr. Naima Harris being one of them, has been doing work in Detroit for a long time, and She would tell you that a good chunk of the wildlife species are in areas that we wouldn't necessarily expect to be habitat. So whether it be vacant lots or actual homes that now serve as refuges that have been abandoned, the ways in which those cities are structured completely and fundamentally change the ways in which we may think that socioeconomic status is related to what species are where. So yes, there's a ton of nuance, especially in the ways that cities have been either abandoned or reinvested in, or how the pace of gentrification has occurred. So for instance, pace of gentrification in San Francisco has overly exceeded gentrification in other areas. So trying to be able to use those maps to start unpacking that may help us get to more answers of why Detroit or other Rust Belt cities may be different. Yeah.
Hey, Chris. I wanted to say, echoing, the raccoons are fantastic.
Yeah.
So is this presentation, so thank you so much. I was wondering if you saw any interesting data trends during COVID when everybody was inside. I'm sure you did see some interesting things. And maybe if there's still like a delta there that you're observing, just any interesting trends that you might want to call up.
Yeah, so most folks will oftentimes think that animals change their behavior dramatically to be more open in spaces at times that they normally wouldn't be. So take a coyote, for instance, and maybe not the San Francisco ones because that's a bad example. They're out whenever they want to be, right? But maybe a coyote normally is out at 3 a.m. and some folks predicted, oh, wow, we're seeing coyotes in the middle of downtown San Francisco at 11 a.m., which is totally uncharacteristic. At least from the data that we have, what they seem to suggest is that animals are becoming more nocturnal. You want to know why? Because people are using green spaces more. Right as the pandemic hit, the only place people could go were to their local green spaces. And most of the animals that were using those local green spaces were like, WTF, are y'all supposed to be at work? What's going on? So then they started to restrict their activity to times of the day that didn't have much human activity. Now, it's not the case for every single city that we've surveyed so far, but for the majority of the cities, there were more people that used parks. And because they used parks more frequently, those animals started to restrict their temporal activity.
Thank you. Yeah, I wonder how that probably impacted pollution as well.
Yeah, it also impacted the number of community reports. So the number of conflict reports, and again, talk to Dr. Wilkinson about this one, increased over time. So they increase as a function of the pandemic, which to be expected, more people in these green spaces, coyotes may not be expecting them. And we're creatures of habit. So for instance, coyotes and collisions tend to be the highest during the fall, and specifically during one period of the year when daylight saving time goes away, because we're super predictable, right? 5 o'clock, traffic picks up till 7:30, and then we're all at home. And then all of a sudden, you shift that by an hour. And again, the coyote is like, can y'all just stay consistent, please? So they're attuned to us.
Coyotes and collisions is an excellent band name.
Yeah.
I will stop hogging the remote. Microphone. Are there any questions?
I will say to band names, hiatus coyote is already taken, so can't take that one. Yeah.
Thanks for your talk. It's really great. Something you said in the kind of intro of the talk grabbed me. That it's something that I think about a lot with my own work. I'm not an urban ecologist.
Sure.
So connecting the genome and the phenome and the environment, it's really hard, right? I think we're struggling to do it generally. And then layering on top of that, all of the different ways that humans are changing the environment, not just the regular like heterogeneity and climate and geography, et cetera. I guess I don't really have a question necessarily,
yeah.
But what I'm getting at is like, how important do you think it is for us to have that baseline understanding in like less impacted areas, sort of understood to some extent, before we start layering on all of these additional, you know, elements that are certainly making the question much more complicated?
Yeah, I mean, I should say that I've talked about a lot in this talk, right? I covered maybe too much ground in an hour. I could have used this as an entire session for my urban ecology course. But one of the things that I said to Lauren a couple days ago is that the best way to start is actually visiting these neighborhoods. So we, as scientists, have a bad habit of doing some parachute science, right? We collect some data. We hope those data make the connections to where we need them to be. We use GIS maps that are very much just disentangled from the people that live in those areas. We publish a paper, we move on to the next project. And I think it's important for us to recognize that the work that we're doing is based in a place that also needs a lot of sympathy and empathy, to the point where when we're doing the community work, we drive the streets, we talk to the people, we see what's happening in these neighborhoods, and we ask people what they need, right? Now, of course, we can't give them everything. We are not unlimited beings, but certainly we have a skill set and a level of privilege that gives us the opportunity to do some good work. Something as simple as saying, hey, we'd love to work with you guys through your youth education environmental science program. We have cameras that we can give you and all of the equipment. We'll show you how you can work it, and we'll use the cameras in whatever way you see fit, right? Something as simple as just taking what we think of as inexpensive, not that important, and giving it to folks that have maybe never even seen a camera trap is empowering in a way that allows them to see that they can also be a solution to the many problems. So that's not an answer to say like, that's the only thing you should do, and then we'll be able to figure out the science later, but that it needs to be done in parallel. So that way you understand the biological validity of your science as well as the societal impact. And that's the only way that we're then going to be able to start seeing, well, what are those more groundbreaking connections? And that's tough. That's really hard. It keeps me up at night. So when y'all figure out an answer, let me know. We'll collectively work on it together.
We have a question from the chat.
Yeah.
Megan asks, does wildlife see increase in disease types similar to humans along 880 corridor or similar spaces, i.e. asthma, autoimmune disease, cancer, et cetera?
That is a fantastic question. Locally, we don't have any evidence for that. More globally, there was a recent meta-analysis put together by one of the colleagues we work with, Maureen Murray, who works at Lincoln Park Zoo. And the title of the paper is aptly named City Sicker, because in most instances, urban wildlife tend to be sicker for a whole host of like categories and metrics, whether it be stress physiology, heavy metal pollution, disease dynamics, than they are in non-urban environments. Are they, say, more likely or more prone to catch some particular disease along the 880 corridor? We have no idea, but we'll let you know in a couple of years.
I think we have time for one more from the room.
I just wonder what the most unexpected animals you've come across in the city are, because I live in a very urban neighborhood. My mind was blown when I saw like salamanders, these funny salamanders, skunks, possums, raccoons, like, you know, it seems like everything's out there if you're looking for it. And I just wonder what's out there that we don't see.
Oof. Well, it's hard for me to say which is the most unique, because some of them I see a lot, but the salamanders are definitely one of them. And this one isn't related to my research in any way, but praying mantises. We had a praying mantis all summer last year that just hung out at our faucet in the backyard. And the boy, my 7 and 4 year old, saw the praying mantis, gave him a name. I forget what the name was. And we watched this animal just hang out every single day at the water faucet. And that was remarkable. I didn't expect to see that species, even though they're probably pretty common here, but I also didn't expect to see the animal hang out with us, which really begs the question. We talked a lot about urban evolution and urban adaptation and how these unique species are making it work in a city, but they shouldn't have to, right? Like, in some ways, they shouldn't have to deal with our mess. So part of what I think what is the unique piece of the work that we do is being able to put ourselves somewhat in the shoes of the animals that we study. And that has been pretty impactful.
All right.
Well, thanks everyone for attending. Thanks so much, Chris,
thank
for
you.
Your awesome talk, and everyone in the lab who's here. We'll hang out a little bit in this room for a while if y'all want to chat amongst yourselves.
Cool.
So yeah, thanks so much. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks, y'all.